try to. Okay. Announcement. Drew Baker, no one in Drew Baker or his family have confirmed COVID. So please let's make sure that we know that. At this moment, he had a sick little boy and the boy went to the doctor and a COVID test was obtained. The results of the test are not back, so they are under self-quarantine until the results are back. And you may or may not know, 90% of people who are tested for COVID are not found to be positive for COVID. So I want to change that rumor or that impression right away, is that neither Drew nor his sons nor his wife at this moment are confirmed to have COVID. So this is just an appropriate precaution that he's staying home until the results of the COVID test are back. So want to make sure that that is clear. I'm Diane Wells. I'm here to fill in for him. I actually am a member of this church. I just don't come too often. For obvious reasons. So I'm going to try to work off two bulletins here, which I usually have trouble working off one, so this may be a challenge, but we will try. And I'm going to do what I do at my church, and now if you'll look at the Shiloh Wesley bulletin, it says, God is good all the time. God is enough and all the time. All right, so with that, I welcome you to our service this morning. The invocation in my bulletin, I'll call it. Lord, we've tried everything we can think of. Every road has seemed a dead end. Doors have been so consistently shut in our faces that you must be trying to teach us something. Tell us what it is. Amen. And so let's hear God speak to us through our singing this morning.
Straight to the rising way of these things we pray in your precious name. Amen.
And, okay, I'm a little off schedule already, but we'll make it work. I am going to return to announcements, and let me see. I noticed on the back of your bulletin, you are making a directory in just a couple of months, so be sure and make phone calls and make connection with that, because that's a very special time to have a directory. I can't tell you how many times we look into that to get the identification of people. So, and I'm going to walk back up here, grab my clock thing. All righty. Now, so the directory is there. Yes, the men's group at Shiloh is going to be meeting the first Saturday of the month, so please be aware of that, and it's just a great privilege to get the men together. I know you won't be working. It's just a time to have coffee and have a conversation with other men that are trying to walk with Christ there. I also would say on the back of my bulletin, that's the Shiloh Wesley. You will find at the bottom of that is the announcements for WOW. We are still taking reservations for WOW at Shiloh Wesley this Saturday. I will tell you, the speaker is outstanding. Michelle Medlock Adams has written over 70 books. About two-thirds of them are children's books. She also has conferences helping people learn how to get their stuff published. And so she will be presenting to us three times. One time her sister Martha, who has a Sisters 2 online Bible study, will be presenting as well. And the timing of that WOW program has changed. We've reduced the time so that doors will open about 8, music will start at 9, the program, the speaker will start about 9:30, and it will close at 3. The reason for the reduction is it will only have one lunch break and one cookie break to limit the exposure of people. Obviously, I was there this morning, and the chairs are spread out in either solo chairs, two chairs, or three chairs, but still so people can spread out through the sanctuary. I would also say if you're interested in coming, please let us know by phone or email so we have a lunch for you, and we will keep careful count of the people coming. But if you want to come and you say, I really am not sure I want to be in the sanctuary, you can sit outside because we are set up to provide that. So as you feel led. So that's WOW, that's the men's Bible study. Spencer United Methodist Church has developed a room for children to go into and wiggle and play and be taken care of. So there's no age limit on that, children, but I can say if you've got a tie on, you certainly don't need to go in there. But you can go in there and use that place to maintain your activity level. And just because you're sleeping, you want to take a nap, is not a reason to go. You can sleep in your pew just fine till someone elbows you. But otherwise, please feel free to check it out and use it as you feel led, because we just want to make the Word of God, the sanctuary, we want it to be a friendly place and a safe place where everyone is welcome. Not feels welcome, but we want you to be welcome there. Those are the only announcements I know about at this moment. There was at my church, there was a young baby named Odin who had a burn on much of his body from hot water. And so he's at the Riley having surgery. So remember baby Odin. Other prayers, praises, or concerns. Jack Robert. Charlie Blair is in the hospital emergency room, seriously ill. Remember Charlie. Other prayers, praises, or concerns? All right. I know there's lots of unspoken prayers in this time that we have. Dear God, we come to you this morning confused, sometimes afraid, certainly distracted and distressed. Help us as we are in this sanctuary to know that you are here and to remember that you are everywhere, to remember that you are enough and you are good and you are God. God, you know how broken we are, how self-centered and prideful we can be. Forgive us. Help us to accept your forgiveness and your love, and help us to extend your forgiveness and love to other people. Help us to be the presence of Christ wherever we go. As we open your word today, may you be glorified. As we hum the hymns and songs of praise that we've had, may they lift our spirits and may we lift the spirits of others. There are people in nursing homes who are desperate for visits and can't have them. There are people who are awaiting test results and are anxious and confused. There are people who have received test results, whether it's COVID or cancer or heart disease, and they're scared and their families are scared. God, we wonder why you have permitted the brokenness in the world, and then we realize that you have permitted it, we have caused it, and you are the answer. And there is still hope, there is still help, you are the answer. So help us to live like we know that, Father. Forgive us for doubting your presence, your power, and thank you for your patience. Dear Father, I pray this morning from the bulletin, oh Lord, I have a busy world around me. Eye, ear, and thought will be needed, or all my work will be done in that busy world in vain. Now, before I enter it, I would commit eye, ear, and thought to thee. Do thou bless them and keep their work thine, such as through thy natural laws my heart beats, my blood flows without any thought of mine. So may my spiritual life hold on its course at those times when my mind cannot consciously turn to thee, to commit each particular thought to thy service. Hear my prayer for the dear Redeemer's sake. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. All right. Okay. All right. I just realized there's a camera there, so I'm not going to move around too much. I'll try really hard. All righty. I'm going to read scripture from James 2 with some selections, 14 through 24, and I think this is from the Message. My dear brothers and sisters, what good is it if someone claims to have faith but demonstrates no good works to prove it? How could this kind of faith save anyone? For example, if a brother or sister in the faith is poorly clothed and hungry and you leave them saying, "Goodbye, I hope you stay warm and have plenty to eat," but you don't provide them with a coat or even a cup of soup, what good is your faith? So then, faith that doesn't involve action is phony. But someone might object and they might say, "One person has faith and another has works. Go ahead then and prove to me that you have faith without works, and I will show you my faith by my works as proof of what I believe. You can believe all you want that there is one true God. That's wonderful. But even the demons know this and tremble with fear before him, yet they're unchanged. They remain demons." And continuing to verse 21, "Because of his works, when Abraham offered his son Isaac on the altar, don't you see how his action cooperated with his faith, and by his action, faith found its full expression? Because Abraham believed God, his faith was exchanged for God's righteousness, so he became known as a lover of God. So now it's clear that a person is seen as righteous in God's eyes, not merely by faith alone, but by works." The word of God for the people of God. Praise be to God. Dear Father, may the words I speak be those which point people to Jesus. May we go to him in faith, and may we serve him in faith, and may they see him in our lives for our growth and your glory, in Christ's name. Amen. All right, this morning I am going to talk from James, and I'm going to move things like this. The thing I want you to hear me say this morning, because I do believe strongly that it's biblical, faith has consequences. I mean, you know, choices have consequences. What we do have consequences. And if your faith does not change the way you behave, then I'm not sure you really believe. If you do not believe that God is God, He is the only God, if you do not believe that God is good and God is enough all the time, then you are going to behave in fear. You are going to behave in trembling. You are going to behave in unforgiveness and pride and judgment and righteousness and self-righteousness. But once you really believe, you really, really believe as much as you can that God is good all the time and the events of this world have been permitted. I didn't say they have been caused, but the events of this world have been permitted by the God of the universe, and He has the ability, the power, the presence, and the potential, and the love, and the presence to make them work out for your good and His glory, no matter what. And that includes COVID. That includes cancer. That includes all the ugliness and brokenness that is in our lives and in our world and hurts like hell and doesn't make any sense at all. But God is good all the time. And as we wrap our mind around the power of God, then we believe. And that belief changes everything. When you believe that you have found someone who you have every intention, every desire to love the rest of your life, and that they are going to love you the rest of your life, your behavior changes. I mean, you don't have a list of things and say, okay, well, since I believe that this is the relationship that's going to make all the difference in my life, I'm going to do 6 out of the 10 most important things that they want me to do. I mean, that doesn't sound like a relationship. That sounds like a negotiation. Belief is not a negotiation. Belief is a commitment. Belief is a decision. Belief is a decision. And that's what, and I pray that everyone here and everyone in every church who is hearing the word of God absolutely knows that Jesus Christ is the only begotten Son and the resurrected Son of God and is now sitting at the right hand of the Father. And I pray that you know that if for whatever reason you pass away now, you die, you will go to heaven, you will be received into the arms of the Father, and your sins are forgiven. If you don't know that, then please call me, call Drew. Make an effort right now to make sure that you receive that information and you grab hold of that information, because that's the most important message that you and I, in fact, that's why we are here. That is why we are saved. We were saved, why Jesus Christ died for us, so we can spread the word that God is enough. Belief in Jesus Christ is enough to forgive you. I don't care what you've done. And God doesn't care what you've done. He just wants to pick you up, clean you up, and send you on a way to glory. Now, having said how important belief is, and that's what James said, by the way, I know some people will argue, well, Paul says faith is everything, and James says you have to behave. They are not arguing anything but two sides of the absolute same coin. Two sides of the same fact. If you believe, you will. And the first word, if you want to fill it out there, is believe that Jesus Christ is the living, resurrected Son of God sitting at the right hand of the Father to receive you for all eternity. However, if you believe that, you will, as a consequence, as an inevitable consequence, behave like that is the only eternally true and the most important fact in your existence. Most important fact in your existence. Your behavior will change. It must change, or you don't really believe it. I mean, if you believe that you love this person with your whole life and they are the most important thing with you, then you're going to behave different. James is telling us, if you believe in Jesus Christ, your behavior will change. If your behavior doesn't change, then you don't really believe. And we know that both John the Baptist and Jesus, when they started their ministry, said, repent and change your ways. Repenting was believing that Jesus was who He said He was. Repenting was knowing that you needed a Savior. believing was that, but then when you repent, you change your ways. Repent means to turn from what you're doing and be more. You are called to change your ways. And I don't mean just change them a little bit. Loved ones, before we found Christ, our ways did not need to be tweaked. Do you understand that? You didn't need just a little cleanup, just a little drive-through wash, and you'd be okay. No, we all, without Jesus, we all need a serious makeover. We need a serious makeover. And that is what Jesus Christ invites us to have, invites us to do, is a serious makeover. So I want you to understand that your behavior is Christian. Saint Francis said, preach the gospel all the time, and if necessary, use words. You don't have to preach the gospel with words. You preach it with the way you behave, which brings me to my next point. You are to believe, you are to behave, and actually the answers are at the bottom, by the way. You are to become Jesus. Now, here's where people have trouble. They say, well, I'm better than a lot of people, and I'm better than I used to be, but you really want me to become a little Jesus? No, I don't want you to, but I can tell you Jesus expects you to. Jesus died so you can. The Holy Spirit came from heaven to live in you so you can become Jesus. Now, I realize that's a high order, and you can't do it. Of course you can't do it. That's why you have to die, and Jesus Christ has to live in you. The Holy Spirit has to live in you. Jesus Christ did not come and die so you could be a better person. He died so you could be made dead to this world and alive in Him. He came to make people dead in their sins alive. We are not called to be better. We are not called to be nicer. We are not called to be more just. We are called to be alive in Christ and dead to self. He said, come and follow me. I will transform you. We are to be transformed into the likeness of Jesus Christ. That means 24/7. That means 24/7, we are to respond like Jesus would have us respond. We are to love like Jesus loves. We are, in fact, let me tell you this. When you become a Christian, you have the potential to have the patience of Job, to have the passion and persistence of Peter, to have the love of John, to have the forgiveness of Stephen, and to have the generosity of God Himself. Now, that's a tall, impossible order. But with the power of the Holy Spirit living in you and living through you, you are expected to do it. You know, I have this phone here, and it does a lot of things, and most of them I don't know how to do. But it's actually paid for. It's mine. So it could do them, but I don't require it to. I don't make it, and I can't do it, really. That's not a big deal. But here's the problem. You and I, if we have received Jesus Christ, have the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit in us. And most of the time, we don't use it. We don't call upon our Holy Spirit to give us more patience, like Job. More passion, like Peter. More love, like John. And more forgiveness, like Stephen. And more generosity, like God Himself. It came with the package, guys. When you knelt at the cross, when you received the Savior into your life, you were meant, you were empowered, you got all the software you need to be Jesus. You just don't activate it. And God forgive us. And when I get to heaven, I'm not going to regret not having convinced somebody of doing something. I'm not going to resent. I was thinking this week about, would you know what I mean if I say a zinger slinger? You know, those people that just throw zingers out all the time and be, wow, that hurt. You know, I will not regret not having said something clever or smart or nasty or whatever. The only thing I will regret, and there won't be regrets in heaven, I understand, but I will regret not having loved more, not having forgiven more, not having been more persistent in forgiving people, loving people in the name of Jesus. I'm not going to get up there and say, man, see, God, I was right about that. I am going to be humbled, humiliated, and praising God and wished I had praised him more and wished I had loved more in his name, because that's what Jesus did and that's what we have the power to do. And God, forgive us when we don't and kick us in the whatever and make us move on. COVID is not the problem. Politics are not the problem. The impotence of the body of Christ in loving and living in his name is the problem with the world today. We need a revival in our hearts, in our lives, in our churches. They are not the problem. The answer is here, and the answer needs to come alive in the body of Christ. And let me tell you one more thing. Believe, behave, become. Trust that in the world beyond, that's the one I'm talking about, forever together, in the world beyond, you will have no regrets over every choice and every action made in love. You will not regret anything that you did in the name of Jesus. You will not regret anything that you did from a heart of love and forgiveness and passion. Now, there's other stuff. Sin goes right through the middle of every, right, well, I don't know about the middle, but sin goes right through at everyone's heart. The problem for your life is sin in your heart. The heart is devious beyond man's imagination. You know, I can be an extraordinarily nice Christian person when everything goes my way. But it doesn't always do that. And so there's a song that it's got that. If you look in your, there's a song after the sermon says, "When Life is Good Again." It's by Dolly Parton. I'm not going to sing it. But if you have the email kind of thing and you bring it up, it's Dolly Parton sings, "When life gets good again, you know, I'll be nicer, I'll be loving, I'll open my heart." I got news for you guys. God, life is as good as it's going to be right now. Today is your day. Life is good because God is good, and this is our chance to be Jesus wherever we are. Mask on, doesn't matter. Fever, not, doesn't matter. Weak, Paul, weak. Strong, poor, rich, in authority, not in authority, exhausted, tired. None of those things matter. Today is the day. Be good right now. Be Jesus right now. Be powerful in the words of love of Jesus right now. There's only 2 days, today and that day. Today is your day to love. That day in heaven will be when we fall at his knees and say, "Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Dear God, I love these people. I love this church. But above all else, I love you. And help me to live and behave in a way that lets other people know I love you, I love you. I don't deserve it. I didn't deserve it when you took me. I don't deserve it now. But I thank you. In Jesus' name, amen." I have to figure out what's next, Kathy. Oh, that's a good idea. That's a good idea. Oh, yeah. That's a good idea. I know what we'll do. We'll sing the doxology. I love the doxology. And then I will give the benediction. Okay? That works. Please stand.
Praise God from whom?
Benediction from the bulletin says, "Thank you, Lord, that you will be our hiding place, whatever happens." Amen and amen.
Are we going to do a final hymn? Mm-hmm.
Okay. The hymn. There we go.
want to read a notice from the Spencer Evening World from December 31st, 1928. I was in there for a movie, so I had reason to read this. And in the Spencer Evening World, it said on that date, Cloverdale, Indiana, December 31st, school will not reopen in Cloverdale on account of influenza epidemic. Nearly every family in the township is affected. I want you to understand that what we are going through is not unheard of. We will survive. God has permitted it. I also want to give you a piece of advice. Is please take it upon yourself with your mouth and with your speech is to not make statements that are an opinion as a fact. The polarization of our world, the polarization in our churches, in our community, comes in part from sin, of course, but it comes in part because people have developed the need to state their opinion as a fact. Anyone who doesn't wear a mask is stupid and cruel. Anyone who does wear a mask is afraid and doesn't trust God. Anyone who does this is whatever. Anyone who votes that way is selfish. Anyone who votes that way doesn't understand. Loved ones, by all means, have an opinion. Have a thought through, prayed for, considered opinion. And if you have the need to share it, although I will recommend that probably very few people care about your opinion, but if you feel the need to share it, then all right. But please, as a Christian, as a loving person, as a humble person who knows that the authority is God and not you and not them, then offer your opinion in this fashion. In my opinion. In my opinion. It doesn't make sense to do that. In my opinion, people should do this. Now, you are welcome to your opinion. You may find someone who cares. But really, I'm inviting you to consider that spewing your opinion everywhere like it's a fact. There's no way to discuss it, loved ones. When someone says, people who do this are stupid and selfish, that really